We welcome you this evening from the Tabernacle on Temple Square in Salt Lake City as we join together in a special commemoration of the 90th birthday of our beloved Prophet President Ezra Taft Benson. We extend greetings to those assembled in the Tabernacle and the Assembly Hall and to members of the Church in the United States, Canada, and Puerto Rico who are participating via satellite transmission or who will watch this service on KBYU-TV at 8 o'clock this evening. We acknowledge on the stand many of the general authorities and also extend to President Benson the love of the brethren who are on assignment abroad at the present time. We express our deep appreciation to the Benson family who have been instrumental in assisting with the program this evening. Many are in attendance tonight. I'm sure, President and Sister Benson, you are justifiably proud of this most exemplary family. The music for this program is being furnished by the Tabernacle Choir under the direction of Gerald D. Otley with John Longhurst at the organ. The choir will begin this commemorative service by singing one of President Benson's favorite hymns, I Believe in Christ, following which the invocation will be offered by Elder Boyd K. Packer, a member of the Council of the Twelve.
I believe in Christ. Our Holy Father in heaven, we assemble in these many congregations to commemorate the 90th birthday of President Ezra Taft Benson. We are grateful to be here and to participate in this hour in a saga, an epic in the history of the church, the life of a man that has moved from plowboy to prophet, following the footsteps of those who have held this office before and honoring the office equally. We pray for President Benson tonight that he will have rejoicing and inspiration. And as we show honor to him, we show honor to his wife, Flora Benson, for they are inseparable. And we do honor to a family and to the principle of family, to a father and a mother who had faith, humble faith, who raised their sons and daughters to have fervent testimonies of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we do honor to this man, a man of great station in life and in the church, who has never lost his humility, who's maintained his fervent testimony, and has the certain witness of thee. We love this prophet, president of ours. We sustain him. We pray that thou wilt sustain him, our Holy Father, for many years yet to come. We invoke thy blessings upon those who will participate, particularly those of the family, that they will be blessed as they participate in word and music, and that inspiration will attend them and us, and that we will all be inspired and rejoice in this great event, all of which we pray for in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
The Tabernacle Men's Chorus will now sing another beloved hymn of President Benson, I Need Thee Every Hour, following which we shall be pleased to hear special tributes to President Benson from Sister Margaret Benson Keller, eldest sister of President Benson, and Sister Barbara Benson Walker, eldest daughter of President and Sister Benson. Sister Walker will conclude her remarks with a special solo entitled, Oh My Papa, accompanied by John Longhurst. Following their remarks, we shall see a short film entitled, The Journey of Ezra Taft Benson, which will highlight the life of this devoted servant of the Lord. At the conclusion of the film, we shall see a special greeting and honor recorded by President George Bush, President of the United States.
Oh, I was truly grateful for those beautiful songs from the Tabernacle Choir. I am also grateful for the support and the love of my dear family and friends who have helped me to come to Salt Lake tonight. My dear brothers, sisters, and family, humility, respect, gratitude, and love are the feelings in my heart as we pay honor to this great man who is our prophet and my brother. I am indeed thankful for his love, prayers, and consistent example of courage and righteous living throughout his life. When you see a man on top of a high mountain, you know that he didn't fall there. Yet, like a prophet of God, he started at the bottom and worked his way up, one step at a time through struggle, hard work, dedication, faith, prayer, and obedience, gaining strength and courage as he climbed. Sometimes slipping back a little when the mount was too steep, but quickly grasping again the iron rod to continue climbing to the top. Being the eldest grandson of George T. Benson I and great-grandson of Apostle Ezra Taft Benson, Ezra T. was an inspiration and the joy of his noble family. Mother taught him when very young to be very respectful and polite to others. So one day, as he went to Grandmother Dunkley's house, and they were sitting around the dining room table for dinner, Ezra T. was about 2 years old. Grandmother sat a large bowl of boiled eggs on the table, and Ezra looked at the eggs, bowed his head slightly, and said, "How do you do, eggs?" He learned quickly and was an outstanding student. His love of sports taught him to think and act with precision and speed. Our prophet was a happy, normal boy, full of laughter, boyish pranks, joking and teasing. He loved to sing and play the trombone. There was never a dull moment for him around our house with 10 fun-loving brothers and sisters. Father and mother were happy people, singing as they worked. The first thing in the morning, we would hear our father singing, "Clear the darkened windows, open wide the door, let a little sunshine in," as he would pull back the drapes, open the door, and shake the old grate on the old kitchen stove. We knew that we would soon hear the call. T, Joe, Margaret, Arbel, and so on down the line of 11 children. Ezra T was the first one up to milk his cows. Father was a great teacher and motivator. He taught as our Heavenly Father teaches. You pay a full tithing, and I'll open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. Well, Father would say, when that field of beets is thinned, I'll take you all boating and fishing at Bear Lake or on a camp out. There was always a reward for work well done. And Ezra often tried to see how much work he could do in a day. He loved the challenge. I always felt there was an angel watching over him as he operated the big machinery on the farm, rode horses at top speed, whirled around the corners on the big bobsleigh, but never that I remember having an accident. We were all excited when we got our first little car. Ezra T. took his friends for a thrilling ride. He pushed the gas pedal until he was flying at top speed, 25 miles an hour. When he told Mother about the adventure, she exclaimed, "Ezra T., you could have been killed." The neighborhood children loved to congregate at our home, and Ezra T., being a natural leader, taught them to play basketball, softball, and all the games of youth. Always there was a requirement: obey the rules and play fair. He learned at an early age to supervise a farm and help his mother manage six children when father left to serve a mission. During this time, the future prophet grew from a boy to a man. He learned responsibility and unwavering faith in the Lord. When the Lord speaks, you always act immediately. He witnessed a miracle while Father was gone, as Mother was healed through her faith, refusing to let the doctor send word for Father to come home. "The Lord will take care of me," she said. One time, a newcomer in our Whitney ward, who obviously hadn't heard my name, asked me if I was going steady with Ezra Taft Benson. She had seen us attend our meetings, activities, and dances together so often. In the summertime, there was usually a Saturday night steak dance in the old opera house in Preston for the young people. I remember going to the dance one night with my two brothers, Ezra T. and Joe. And this certain young man asked me if he could take me home from the dance. Well, I smiled a little, for I knew the answer, but I wanted him to get it firsthand, so I said, "Well, you'll have to ask my brothers, because I came with them." He asked them, and they said, "Well, of course you can't take her home from the dance. She's our partner. We brought her to this dance, and we intend to take her home. Now, if you want to take her home next Saturday night, you come and get her." Well, he did, and I married that man a few years later. When I was a young mother, I lived on a ranch in a small town of Mink Creek, Idaho, a little ways from Preston, Idaho. I had four little children and was expecting my fifth. My husband was gone buying cattle for a few days. It was fall, the nights were chilly, and I had felt ill all day. But as the day darkened into nighttime, I began to feel worse. I was concerned and a bit frightened. I prayed fervently to the Lord for help. "Please send someone." About 9:30, a knock came at the door. "Ezra T. Benson, how did you get way up here from Salt Lake?" I exclaimed. "I was coming down from an assignment for the church in northern Idaho," he said. "When I got in Preston, I had a strong feeling and impression that I should come here." Oh, the joy I felt. The Lord had heard my prayers. My brother had responded immediately. He gave me a blessing and promised me that all would be well. He advised me to get some rest. He stayed overnight and helped with the children. The next morning I was better. So he left his blessings on our home and family and went back to Salt Lake City. When I am with him, I feel loved, warm, peaceful, and of great worth. How I love him. "We will support you 100% are the words I have often heard from the lips of his dear wife as he would leave home on an assignment. How much easier it was for him to leave when he knew he had the blessings and the faith of his loving family. He often speaks of the love and the appreciation he has for the great man he works with in the church. Our prophet is a helpful, grateful man, blessing all who touch his life. Our Heavenly Father is his senior companion, daily giving him guidance. His contact with heaven is direct and regular. No sacrifice is too great for he and his loving wife to make for the Lord and his children. How blessed we are to have a prophet who hears the voice of the Lord and teaches us to cling to the iron rod and partake of the fruits of eternal life. I know he is a prophet of God, not only for us, but for the whole world. God bless him. Our Father in heaven lives. He hears and answers prayers. I bear you this humble testimony with all my heart and soul. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
I'm grateful tonight for the privilege of speaking on behalf of my brothers and sisters in honoring our noble father. Like Nephi of old, we were born of goodly parents. On the concluding page of the biography of our father, the author discusses Dad's loyalty to God, to family, and to country. These are mankind's three great loyalties. In our father's life, he has lived these loyalties. Loyalty to God as a prophet, loyalty to family as a patriarch, and loyalty to country as a patriot. Prophet, patriarch, and patriot. For over 40 years, he served as a worthy follower and a special witness of Jesus Christ, even as an apostle. Today, he is the prophet of God, moved by his master to flood the earth and our lives with another testament of Jesus Christ, the Book of Mormon. For 8 years, he served his country well in the cabinet of the President of the United States. He has been valiant in raising the voice of warning in the fight for freedom. A patriot like Captain Moroni, he has left us a legacy of holding aloft the title of liberty. Finally, for his loyalty to family as a patriarch, we children wish to pay him particular honor tonight. First, we wish to thank him for his exemplary life. He has said that the youth need more models than they do critics, and he has been a wonderful model. He likes the rhyme that begins, "I'd rather see a sermon than hear one any day. I'd rather one would walk with me than to merely point the way." Not only has he pointed the way for us, but even more important, he has walked with us. Thanks so much, Dad. Of his many virtues, one that stands out is his integrity. Once he has determined that a course is right, he is dogged and courageous in pursuing it. He has said, "Help us to be right and then easy to live with, if possible, but in that order." Our father's greatest decision was to follow the Lord. His next greatest decision was to marry our mother. We're so grateful that he did. He has often stated that our mother had more faith in him than he had in himself. One of the brethren said that if we had more sisters in the kingdom like Sister Benson, we'd have more brethren in the kingdom like Brother Benson. Our father has said, happy is the man who has found his worship, his wife, and his work, and loves all three. Our father found them and loves them. We remember Dad as an early riser and a hard worker. The perspiration used to pour off his face as he worked with us in the garden. He frequently pitched in to help in the home, washing the dishes, doing the laundry, vacuuming the whole house, and he did it with vigor, though it may not have been total joy. Dad likes to include us. Like Lehi, he was anxious that his family might partake of the good things he knew about. At supper time, he'd share things that happened at the office. A great letter writer, he was constantly sending us choice articles, clippings, and books. Each one of us has been on trips alone with Dad. He'd take us to his church and civic talks, and when he testified before a congressional committee. It was no accident that he had a child with him at the time he was called to the Quorum of the Twelve, and again when he was sworn in as the Secretary of Agriculture by the Chief Justice in the White House. Dad worked at keeping his life in balance. He felt as much at home pitching softballs as preaching sermons. He spent many an hour hitting us flies and grounders. None of us children ever beat him at horseshoes, though our chances are improving. Our father hasn't lusted for office. He has often said, "Blessed is he who expecteth nothing, for he shall never be disappointed." But Dad has been anxious to serve, whether it be the farmers of America or the distressed saints in Europe at the close of the war. Service like charity begins at home, and we children have been the grateful recipients of our father's time, his counsel, and his companionship. My brother Reed remembers as a boy putting on his bed all the books he planned to read one summer while herding turkeys. He invited Dad in for his evaluation. Our father commended Reed for his selections and then had one suggestion. That was to leave them all home and take just one book. Do you want to guess what book that was? That's right, it was the Book of Mormon. Reed did so and has blessed our dad ever since for that counsel. My brother Mark remembers Dad's visits to scout camp and his promise that as soon as each son received his Eagle Scout award, he'd take him on one of his farm trips. Mark got his eagle and had the time of his life with Dad on a trip into the South. My sister Beverly remembers the kind, caring, courteous way that Dad always treated Mom. He was the same way with us girls. When Dad came to pick up Beverly after piano lessons, there was no horn honking or merely waiting. Instead, Dad met her and walked her to the car. Whether escorting Beverly to a White House function or going to a supermarket. He was always a perfect gentleman. My sister Bonnie remembers a daddy-daughter date when Dad was in the cabinet. He cleared his calendar of his diplomatic functions. That night, there was a scavenger hunt contest. You can imagine the surprise of some of the people in Washington, D.C., to see a member of the president's cabinet and his daughter knocking on doors and asking for shoelaces and toothpicks. Of course, you know I wouldn't tell this story if Dad and Bonnie hadn't won the contest. My sister Beth remembers Dad's willingness to share with her his love of nature. She saw it enrich Dad's life and have a calming and renewing effect on him. She took regular evening walks with him while we lived in Washington, D.C., and occasionally they went to the Marriott Ranch, where they rode horseback together in the early morning hours. Dad and Mom love the Canadian Rockies and Alpine Lakes, and have enjoyed spending many Christmases with us, where he drove horse-drawn cutters for spirited bobsleigh rides. I remember Dad's reverence for the divine role of true motherhood and his loving interest in my own children and grandchildren. Dad has always taught that there is no greater blessing or responsibility that will come to a woman than raising righteous children. My husband and I are very grateful that our children love children, and that our daughters and daughter-in-law enjoy the role of full-time mother and wife. He became acquainted with each of our children's fiancés and performed all of their marriages in the Salt Lake Temple, just as he had done for all of his own children. We all remember the great three-day family reunions that Dad and Mom organized. The grandchildren with Grandpa at the fishing pond, the hay rides, train and horseback rides, the dancing, swimming, games, and family reports and testimony meetings. At our last three-day reunion, there were six different colored shirts to identify the descendants of each of the six children. On the front of each shirt was pictured a home and circled by the words, "We're all here." The words were taken from a poem our father loves that states, "We're all here, father, mother, sister, brother, all who hold each other dear. Each chair is filled, we're all back home." Our father says that in the next life, he wants no empty chairs. He wants to see us all back home, home with our Heavenly Father. May that be the happy lot of us all. I love this great gospel of Jesus Christ. I know it is true beyond a shadow of a doubt. I always have known it was true. I honor and sustain our church leaders. I love our dear prophet, my beloved father, President Ezra Taft Benson. I know he is a prophet, seer, and revelator, and I deeply honor and sustain him. This is my humble testimony in the name of Jesus Christ, for whose atoning sacrifice I'll be eternally grateful. Amen.
This is a tremendously significant and sacred occasion for members of the church throughout the world. The First Presidency will please arise. It is proposed that we sustain Ezra Taft Benson as prophet, seer, and revelator, and president of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints.
My brethren and sisters, I want you to know that I know that Christ is at the helm. This is his world. This is his church. His purposes will be accomplished. I know that.
It's a long journey from Whitney, Idaho, to the cabinet room of the White House, and then to become the Lord's spokesman to the inhabitants of the earth. But such a journey has been Ezra Taft Benson's. In the pages of his journal and other personal accounts, one catches a glimpse of the path he has traveled from farm boy to prophet of God. That path began here, in the hills and valleys of southeast Idaho.
May 23rd, 1912. Father and mother returned home from town today with the mail, and both were in tears. They brought us inside and told us Father had received a mission call. We will all need to shoulder the work of the farm. Through her tears, Mother said, "We are so proud that Father is worthy to serve." Separation would be hard for her.
In a matter of weeks, George Benson was 1,500 miles away. At night, Sarah would gather the seven children around the coal oil lamp in the kitchen and read letters from their missionary father. Ezra recalled, "There came into our home a spirit of missionary work that never left it." In 1921, Ezra himself was called on a mission to Great Britain.
September 13th. The prejudice in this area has been intense. But tonight, we addressed a large crowd at South Shields. I spoke with a freedom I had never experienced. Afterwards, I couldn't recall what I had said, but several non-members surrounded me and said, "Tonight, we received a witness that Joseph Smith was a prophet of God, and we are ready for baptism." It was the first experience of that kind I've had, where I knew the Lord was with me.
In 1926, Ezra Taft Benson graduated with honors from Brigham Young University with a degree in animal husbandry. The student body voted him most popular man. When a certain young lady named Flora Amason returned from her mission to the Hawaiian Islands, it seemed all was aligned for two unique lives to become one.
September 10th, 1926. The wedding ceremony was too beautiful for words. Everything was so quiet and peaceful. It all made us so thankful for the restored gospel and all that it holds out to us. Surely we have never been happier.
Loading all their belongings in the back of an old Model T Ford pickup, the couple drove to Ames, Iowa, where less than a year later, Ezra received a master's degree in agricultural economics from Iowa State University. Then it was back to the farm in Whitney, where Ezra reflected, "We expected to spend the rest of our lives, but it was not to be." Before long, the model farm he operated attracted widespread attention, and he was offered the position of county agricultural agent for the University of Idaho. Spending scarcely 30 days at his desk the first year as county agent, he traversed the back roads of southeast Idaho, helping farmers solve their problems. Word of his effectiveness spread, and a promotion took him to the state capital in Boise. Here, he also served as first counselor in the Boise State Presidency, and then as state president. Eventually, national agricultural leaders became aware of this bright and energetic farm specialist from Idaho. In 1939, the National Council of Farmer Cooperatives in Washington, D.C., invited him to become their executive secretary. The organization's chief operating officer. After much prayer and consideration, the young family moved to Washington.
June 30th, 1939. Spent all day in meetings with the USDA and at the Capitol, lobbying against a certain farm bill. The job appears almost too large for me, but I expect to give it the best I have.
In 1940, the church's first stake in the East was organized in Washington, D.C., and Ezra Taft Benson became its president. Then, 3 years later, while visiting Salt Lake City, an event occurred which would forever change his life.
July 26th, 1943. Was told that President Heber J. Grant wanted to meet with me. He was convalescing from a stroke in his summer home in Emigration Canyon. I was shown into his room where he was resting on the bed. I sat down next to him. He took my hand in both of his and said, "Brother Benson, with all my heart I congratulate you and pray God's blessings to attend you. You have been chosen as the youngest member of the Council of the 12 Apostles." For several minutes, I could only say, "Oh, President Grant, that can't be." He held my hand for a long time as we both shed tears. When I was able to state that I loved the church, he said, "We know that. And the Lord wants men who will give everything for his work."
It would not be long before he would be called upon to do exactly that.
January 29th, 1946. I am leaving today for London for the purpose of reopening missionary work in the war-torn countries of Europe. This is a challenging opportunity for which I am deeply grateful.
During the next 11 months, he traveled over 61,000 often hazardous miles in everything from unheated aircraft to military jeeps. He searched out and met with the starving saints of Poland, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, and the rest of occupied Europe.
February 13th. Drove through once beautiful Berlin. The wreckage cannot possibly be understood unless seen. Later, I faced in a half-wrecked auditorium 480 cold, half-starved, but faithful Latter-day Saints. It was an inspiration to see the light of their faith.
Elder Benson oversaw the distribution of 92 boxcars of food, clothing, and bedding to thousands of war-weary saints. He authorized the printing of 5,000 copies of the Book of Mormon, Doctrine and Covenants, and Pearl of Great Price in German. He organized branches, purchased properties, and rejuvenated missionary work. When he left 11 months later, the saints throughout Europe had a renewed spirit of hope. But challenging missions of service were only beginning for this dedicated disciple of Christ.
You're about to see the Secretary of Agriculture, Ezra Taft Benson, face the nation with questions from veteran correspondents representing the nation's press.
In 1952, President Dwight D. Eisenhower asked Elder Benson to serve as United States Secretary of Agriculture. His acceptance at the urging of President David O. McKay thrust Elder Benson into intensive government service at its highest levels.
At San Francisco Airport, Secretary of Agriculture Benson and Son Reed are welcomed aboard the private plane of Jacqueline Cochran Odlum. The world-famed aviatrix will fly them to El Centro. They next join the $50 a plate diners in the National Guard Armory. Here, Secretary Benson speaks out against continuing rigid wartime price supports, which he says have piled up unmanageable surpluses and reduced farm income.
And as your Secretary of Agriculture, I pledge to you and to farmers everywhere that I will never knowingly support any program or policy which I believe is not in the best interests of our farmers and fair to all of our people, regardless of political pressure.
Upon his return to Utah in 1961, he told the Saints in General Conference, "I have had a conviction through all this period that I was where the Lord wanted me to be. I hope and pray that I will always be where He wants me to be. Even though there were several attempts to draft Elder Benson for political office, he declined those overtures and immersed himself totally in the work of the ministry, keeping a schedule that exhausted those trying to keep up. He served as European Mission President with headquarters in Frankfurt, following which he supervised the work of the church in the Orient. He dedicated Italy, Indonesia, and Finland for the preaching of the gospel and organized numerous stakes throughout the world. Wherever he traveled, he was welcomed by high-ranking government officials who admired and respected him for his work in the Eisenhower cabinet.
Well, yes, we're going back to 1982, and Elder LeGrand Richards was well up in his 90s, and a couple of months before that had had his leg amputated, and he was deteriorating at the time.
And we came into the office of Elder Richards on a Tuesday afternoon, and there were members of the Boundary and Leadership Change Committee, and after the opening prayer, Elder Richards startled everybody by announcing his resignation as the chairman of that committee. And of course, the other members of the committee protested, and they tried to dissuade him from that. And then he said, when the old man gets to the point that he can't any longer carry his responsibility, he ought to turn it over to one of you younger men.
Then the door opened, and there was an atmospheric change as President Benson walked in.
He says, I'm not going to accept your resignation, but I tell you what I am going to do. I'm going to appoint Brother Marv Ashton as the vice chairman of this committee, and you can delegate as much responsibility as you want to him. LeGrand, as long as you live, you will be the chairman of this committee. Well, it's the only time in my experience that I've ever seen LeGrand Richards speechless.
But then the thing that happened next is what was heartwarming for me.
A tear formed in his eye, and he grabbed a hold. He was on a prosthesis at this time. And he grabbed a hold of his big black leather armchair there, and he boosted himself up, and then he worked himself away around the desk. And then President Benson stood up when he saw he was coming around, and the two grabbed each other by the arms, and then he looked up into President Benson's face and said, President, I love you. And President Benson responded, LeGrand, I love you. And then they embraced.
Over the years, he would repeatedly emphasize the home and family in his teachings. Few subjects were closer to his heart. His beloved Flora was one of his greatest sources of strength and comfort. He would often refer to their wedding day, September 10th, 1926, as the day life began. For over 30 years, she had worn daily a golden pendant her husband had given her, inscribed to Flora for constant help, devotion, and inspiration. As 1985 drew to a close, he would discover just how much that inspiration from loved ones and from on high was needed. On the evening of November 5th, 1985, President Benson received word that Spencer W. Kimball, the man he had loved and served with for 42 years, was gone. He and Flora dropped to their knees. In his journal, he recorded, I have never felt weaker, and never before have I felt the influence of the Spirit in such great strength. May the good Lord sustain me as I go forward humbly. He chose Elders Gordon B. Hinckley and Thomas S. Monson to serve as his first and second counselors, respectively. From that day, the love and loyalty manifest by the first presidency has been a lesson in unity for the entire church.
President Benson seemed to have been cradled by the Lord and prepared for the role he now serves as President of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Men of letters, men and women of distinction, come to visit him here at the church office building, but he is never happier than when children come to meet with him. They like the glow in his eyes, and they like his warm smile. And when he embraces these little ones, one thinks of the passage from the Lord, suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, For of such is the kingdom of heaven. When one looks at Ezra Taft Benson, one can say, here's a man for all seasons. I say to the world, he is a prophet of God.
The Lord never makes a mistake. It is he who has chosen, nurtured, cultivated, and directed this his chosen servant. He stands now at the summit of his life, a man whose entire career from boyhood to old age has been consistent in his attention to duty. I extend my love to this great and choice servant who has been called, appointed, and anointed of the Lord to stand as a prophet to this people.
I have a vision of homes alerted, of classes alive, and of pulpits aflame with the spirit of Book of Mormon messages. My beloved saints, I do not know fully why God has preserved my life to this age, but I do know this, that for the present hour, he has revealed to me the absolute need for us to move the Book of Mormon forward now in a marvelous manner. God willing, I intend to spend all my remaining days in that glorious effort.
Ezra Taft Benson, happy birthday. When I told Barbara you were celebrating your 90th birthday, she smiled, shook her head, and said, George, and I thought your birthday cake looked like a bonfire. But we're not here to count candles or the years. We'd rather marvel at all that you've accomplished. From your early days as an Idaho farm boy when you drove a horse and wagon at age 4, your life has been one marked by achievement after achievement. From your distinguished service as Secretary of Agriculture in the Eisenhower administration, through your long involvement with the Boy Scouts, your leadership and hard work have helped so many. But I especially applaud your worldwide contributions to the Church of Latter-day Saints. Since 1921, when you first served as a young missionary in the British Isles, through your calling as a member of the Quorum of the 12 Apostles in 1943, and finally, as president of the church in 1985, your service has been the very model of selfless devotion and compassion. No matter how difficult the task, no matter how distant the problem, you've always been willing to extend a helping hand to those in trouble. But Mr. Secretary, this is more than a birthday greeting. I am pleased to honor you with the Presidential Citizens Medal in recognition of your exemplary service to your country and fellow citizens. But most of all, it is your devotion to freedom, your love of the U.S. Constitution, and your commitment to your wonderful partner, Flora, who's been by your side now for almost 63 splendid years, that makes you a special American indeed. Your integrity, experience, and understanding heart remind me of what Oliver Wendell Holmes once said. Call him not old, who bears eternal summer in his soul. Those candles may be crowded atop your birthday cake today, but in your heart lies a young and vibrant spirit that is a model to all of us. Barbara joins me in wishing you a very happy birthday. God bless you and your wonderful family on this, your very special day.
Wasn't that tremendous? We understand that President Bush will send someone to personally bestow this award on President Benson sometime in the near future. Now, Sister Mary Benson Richards, granddaughter of President and Sister Benson, accompanied by Stephanie Benson Young, will favor us with a flute solo entitled The Lord's Prayer. We shall then be pleased to hear remarks from President Thomas S. Monson, second counselor in the First Presidency.
Just 20 years ago, I accompanied President Benson to Washington, D.C. to attend his final meeting as a member of the National Executive Board of Boy Scouts of America. President Benson had attained the mandatory age for retirement from the board. I was to be his successor, just as he followed George Albert Smith as a member of the board. The ballroom of the hotel was filled with the corporate leaders of America and professional men and women of accomplishment. When President Benson entered the ballroom, every eye instantly turned toward him. In unison, all present stood and applauded. Such was and is the respect which others have for our own beloved prophet and president. I thought of President Benson's lifelong commitment to scouting. No person has better exemplified adherence to the scout oath: on my honor, I will do my best to do my duty to God and my country, and to obey the scout law. to help other people at all times, and to keep myself physically strong, mentally awake, and morally straight. Bestowed upon him is every recognition of scouting leadership, the silver beaver, the silver antelope, the silver buffalo, and the bronze wolf. Locally, regionally, nationally, internationally, he has set a true course. He has marked the way. He has provided a superb example to follow. To fully appreciate the stature of Ezra Taft Benson, one must turn back the pages of his journal, even the years of his life, and ever so quietly visit that modest farm dwelling in Whitney, Idaho, which George T. and Sarah Dunkley Benson and their children reverently called home. There is no more thrilling and inspiring missionary account than the call to George Benson to leave his wife, his seven children, and all that he held dear, and respond with gladness to a call to serve. President Benson was the eldest of the children, and mother was expecting her eighth child. When President Benson tells of his family's experience during this period, tears come to the eyes and feelings of emotion well up within the heart. He describes how his mother would gather the children around the kitchen table, wipe her hands on her apron, and by the light of a coal oil lantern, read to her children letters from their missionary father. This family learned of faith, experienced sacrifice, developed strength, and shared love. Every son, each daughter, filled honorably a full-time mission. From such a setting came President Benson's reverence for his mother, adoration of his father, and loyalty to brothers and sisters. In that household and in his own family today, the Lord and the church come first. How fitting that Ezra Taft Benson, like the Master, increased in wisdom and stature, and in favor with God and man. How blessed the day when he met his eternal companion and sweetheart, Flora Amason, and they became one for all eternity. From the sparse years of graduate school to the heady atmosphere of Washington, their priorities have remained unchanged. The entire church found justifiable pride in the Edward R. Murrow telecast, which featured Ezra Taft Benson and his family at home. Mr. Murrow reported that his fan mail from this show exceeded all other shows. America was starved to see a righteous family learning and living as a family should. These two remarkable sweethearts, T. and Flora, had joyfully journeyed along the pathway of life together. From Idaho, where President Benson served as state president and as county agricultural agent, to Washington, D.C., where again he served as state president and secretary of agriculture, they have blessed the lives of all with whom they have mingled and won the lasting respect of all with whom they have served. Early in the apostolic years, an assignment was to come, which for a time separated these two sweethearts. Like his father, President Benson was called to leave home and family and fill a special mission to war-torn Europe. The magnitude of his call was overwhelming. First, to attend to the spiritual affairs of the church in Europe. Second, to work and make available food, clothing, and bedding to our suffering saints in Europe. Third, to direct the organization of the various missions of Europe. And fourth, one he loved, to prepare for the return of missionaries to those countries. For 10 1/2 months, President Benson labored night and day without respite, blessing the members of the church in Europe, giving them nourishment for their bodies, and everlasting hope for their souls. From the chaos of war came saints scattered, battered, and in need. To them came Ezra Taft Benson with his superb organizational skills and with the inspiration of Almighty God. Through the inspired welfare program of the church, hundreds of tons of life-saving food and clothing were transported across the vast Atlantic Ocean and under the direction of this gifted leader, distributed to the hungry, the cold, and the homeless. It has been my privilege to follow President Benson in one of his extended assignments to Europe. The years have flown by, and many whom he helped have now passed beyond. Yet there remain those who step forward to bless the name of Ezra Taft Benson. Last October, as I dedicated a new chapel in the city of Zwickau in the German Democratic Republic, a devoted man asked that I give his greetings to President Benson. And then he added, "He saved my life. He gave me food to eat and clothing to wear. He gave me hope. God bless him." An excerpt from a letter President Benson sent to Sister Benson and a passage from her letters to him provide a priceless insight into their enduring love and the support they have for each other. President Benson wrote from Hamburg, Germany, Sunday, June 16, 1946. I'll quote, "This day will linger in my memory forever. We held a general session with the large hall, one of the very few not bombed out, filled to capacity and people standing. Nearly 500 attended. Just before the closing song, I had all the children, 8 and under, line up in the middle aisle. And as they walked past me, I gave each one some gum or candy from those you and the children sent. These sweet, eager, but polite little ones almost broke my heart as they looked up with their large eyes and pale faces filled with gratitude. Then I had 11 mothers and babies come up, and I distributed a bar of soap which you sent to each one, and a few safety pins, needles, and thread, and an orange which we had coaxed from the chef at Bremen. Flora, dear, you'll never know how much these few little things meant. These women hadn't seen an orange for 6.5 years. You could see that they had starved themselves to try and give more to their children in true mother spirit. For lunch, some ate a little black bread or some chicken feed in water. From Flora came this reply, quote, "When I get to bed at midnight, then I am praying for you. And I think you're getting up in Europe, and you're praying for me. The only difference is that I'm going to bed, and you're getting up. But we're both praying and thinking of each other at the same time. The tasks which you have been given, those given to you and me, are not beyond our strength, T. Its pangs and toils not beyond our endurance, as long as we have faith in each other. Live our religion, pray always, and have willpower to direct our thoughts and energies along the proper channels. Such is the spirit of him whom we honor tonight, even President Ezra Taft Benson, and of her who stands at his side, Flora Amason Benson. Almost every Friday, they can be found at the temple together, unselfishly performing sacred ordinances in behalf of those who have gone beyond. Their love and respect for one another is beautiful to behold. Seeking an example of love at home, we need not look beyond the family of President and Sister Benson. My wife and I were privileged to attend the Bensons' 62nd wedding anniversary. Children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren rejoiced as the president and his companion held hands and led the group in singing, "Keep the Home Fires Burning, love's old sweet song, and I love you truly. This love which the prophet has for his own children, grandchildren and great-grandchildren, extends to the children of the church, even to the children of the whole world. He respects them, he loves them, and they respect and love him. When they visit, they brighten his day, they light up his life. I love to hear the prophet pray. He addresses his heavenly Father just as though he were right there in the room with him. His petitions are so appropriate in their content and given in a spirit of true humility. President Benson loves the Holy Scriptures, particularly the Book of Mormon. His inspired counsel for the members of the church and all others to live by the teachings of this sacred volume have truly brought each reader closer to God. I know the depth of character, his character, and I know the tenderness of his soul. He treats his counselors with the utmost respect and with the kindest courtesy. My overwhelming desire, President Benson, is to stand by your side unflinchingly and to fulfill to the best of my ability each assignment you give to me. Your own personal testimony echoes my own feelings when you declare, "With all my heart, I love this work, those who lead it, and those who strive to live its teachings. I hope and pray that I shall always be numbered with the faithful Latter-day Saints." President, I join your family, members of the church, and friends and associates worldwide in extending to you the greeting ever dear and ever treasured. Happy birthday, President Benson. May our Heavenly Father ever bless you and respond to your every need as you, with such devotion and spirit, lead the church forward and upward and onward. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
On one occasion 25 years ago, when I had responsibility for the work of the church in Asia, Sister Hinckley and I had completed a long tour beginning with Japan and Korea and ending in India. It was closer to come home by way of Europe. It was a short time before Christmas. President Benson was then presiding over the European missions with headquarters in Frankfurt, Germany. President and Sister Benson graciously met us at the airport and took us to their home. Following that, Sister Hinckley wrote to Sister Benson to thank them for their hospitality and kindness. She said in part, "After going through the Orient and across Asia where there was so little evidence of Christmas, and then to suddenly find ourselves in your beautiful home with the Christmas tree and the lights, the music and the red ribbon staircase, and most of all, the sweet spirit and peace of a Latter-day Saint home was something that will always remain with us. After weeks in hotels and strange cities, you could not possibly know how we felt when we saw you at the airport." Those words of my wife, written a quarter of a century ago, express the feelings of both of us toward these wonderful people whose kindness we have known, whose hospitality we have enjoyed, and whose leadership we have followed for so long. Their daughter Beth was with them at that time, a beautiful, young, and happy girl. It was the Christmas season in the Benson home, but the love we saw there was not unique to that season. It has been felt in this family at all seasons and in all circumstances. The entire church, who have known them and seen them, have been blessed by their example. There's been a constancy about President Benson's life. From the days of his boyhood, he has been consistently faithful to to every calling to serve in the church. There have been no excuses or alibis, no rationalizing to escape responsibility. He has accepted each call, prayed for the ability to fulfill it, and enthusiastically gone to work. The Lord has accepted of his attitude and his efforts, and he has magnified him in a remarkable and wonderful way. Today he stands sustained as prophet, seer, and revelator, and president of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. No greater honor can come to any man. No servant of the Lord has had thrust upon him a greater responsibility. Prayer has been his refuge and his source of strength. Only after praying about the matter has he moved forward with a decision or begun a course of action. Once that course has been determined, there has never been any backpedaling, apology, or deviation. It was so in the years of his service as Secretary of Agriculture. To have been retained by President Eisenhower a full 8 years was a singular and remarkable thing in itself. Many of the Secretary's decisions and implementing procedures were unpopular, but with him it was not a matter of popularity, it was a matter of principle, and regardless of public criticism, he held to his course. Many of those who criticized came to realize that the Secretary's decisions were right and based on sound economic principle. Self-reliance has been the touchstone of his remarkable career. He learned it in the hard days of farming while he was yet a small boy. There was no government assistance then for farmers or for almost anyone else. People had to make their own way in life. They had to make their own preparations for old age. As state president during the difficult days of the Depression, as general authority in the years since, he has preached and practiced self-reliance, industry, and thrift. He has pleaded with our people to stay out of debt. Many who have hearkened to his message have been blessed by so doing. In the film we have seen this evening, we have heard him speak with great power and persuasiveness. He has been a most effective advocate. Even those who have disagreed with him have admired the clear-cut manner of his message and the persuasive power of his personality. Now the mark of age is beginning to show. We are not surprised. He has worn the harness of major responsibility with great energy all through these 9 decades of time. What a remarkable season in the history of the world his life encompasses. In his younger years, the fastest thing a man alone could ride was a good saddle horse, and he rode many of these. Family transportation was with horse and buggy. Group transport was accomplished on bumpy steam trains that stopped at every town along the way. He has seen the whole gamut, from a trotting horse to a giant jet plane racing through the skies. He feels equally at ease in a hay barn or a mighty airport. He loves good animals. He likewise appreciates a good automobile and a good airplane. He never travels without his companion. She was separated from him while he was in Europe, under the special call received from the presidency of the church to which reference has been made. Those were hard and lonely times for both of them. Today she goes where he goes. This companionship is a cherished blessing to each of them. Now, with the mantle of age resting upon them, they cannot move as fast as they once did. Tears of emotion come more easily. But there is the same love, the same respect, the same consideration as has existed through all of the many years of their marriage. I have noted in these recent years another facet of President Benson's nature to which Brother Monson has made reference. I have had occasion to hear him pray. It has happened many, many times while we have been at his side. His prayers are different. He does not ask the Lord for much, but he thanks him for every blessing. His prayers are primarily expressions of gratitude. Small favors extended him are remembered with thanksgiving before the Lord. He speaks with gratitude for the church, for the land in which we live, for family, for all the good things of heaven and earth which he has come to know and appreciate. He prays as one who is moved by the voice of revelation which declares, "Thou shalt thank the Lord thy God in all things." In a world so filled with selfishness and greed, in a society so obsessed with getting and spending, what a beautiful thing it is to hear a prophet pray and express his gratitude to the Lord whom he loves and serves. His example is a lesson for each of us. His remarkable emphasis on the Book of Mormon has yielded good beyond measure. Many thousands who otherwise might not have done so have read and reread this book. Some of us have seen the letters, the cards, the scrolls of names of those who have expressed their thanks for the motivation he has given them to read and ponder this unique and powerful witness of Christ. As a boy, he milked cows while seated on a three-legged stool. Such a stool would not stand unless all three legs are firmly in place. Loyalty, gratitude, and faith. These are the triad of virtues on which the pattern of his life was established and on which it has been lived. Each of these virtues has been complementary to the other as he has walked these many decades with steady and unfaltering stride. President Benson, before you speak to us, may I express for the entire church our gratitude for your life, for the goodness of it, for the wonder of it, for the strength of it. May I express our love for your example and your leadership. May I express our love for the goodness which we see in you and which is reflected from you to the blessing of each of us. We pray for you now and in our private and family prayers. We are mindful of your oft-expressed love for us. Please know of our love for you. And may God bless you and your wonderful companion now and in the future, that we may draw strength from you as you stand as our leader, chosen, nurtured, refined, and prepared by the Lord for your tremendous responsibility. We shall follow as you lead. We shall sustain you in your high and holy calling. In you reside all of the keys of the priesthood on the earth at this time. With those of other generations we sing, we thank thee, O God, for a prophet to guide us in these latter days. I began my remarks on a personal note. I desire to conclude similarly. As you know, President Spencer W. Kimball called me to serve as a counselor. Following that, his health seriously deteriorated. President Tanner subsequently passed away, and President Romney became largely incapacitated. Mine was the responsibility to carry the burdens of the First Presidency. President Benson was then president of the Council of the 12 Apostles. He was my senior by 11 years in age, and 18 years my senior in the apostleship. But without reservation and without hesitancy, he sustained me in my office in the presidency. I took many matters to the Council of the Twelve for discussion and consideration, and he, as the leader of that quorum, was unfailingly loyal to the office of the First Presidency. It was a great lesson to me. I hope it was to the entire church. Perhaps you can understand why I have appreciated and loved this man so deeply. When he became president of the church, he called me to be his counselor. I was honored beyond measure. I pledged then, and I now renew my pledge of loyalty and love, and repeat my desire and willingness to do whatever I can to assist in any way possible with the many burdens of your office. And so, our dear friend, our leader, our prophet, on this anniversary of your birth, we express our gratitude and affection that the watch care of the Lord may be over you, that the love of the people may continue to sweeten your days, that the loyalty of the people may continue to sustain you, is our humble prayer, which we ask in the name of him whom you serve, even the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. President, can you come up here, Brother Monson? Bring him up here.
We'll do it. He's going to present the vote.
Now, let me just say one more thing. What do you give to a man who's 90 and has everything? In thinking of this, we have concluded, President, to present to you on this occasion this beautifully leather-bound book, which contains expressions from your counselors and each of the Council of the Twelve, which we give with love and blessing and affection. Thank you. Now, would you like to say something to these people here?
I have spent some time thinking of what I might say. God bless you. And sustain you. And good life. Every
they're all there, President. All of the 12 and your counselors.
Hello. I love you, my brethren and sisters, and pray God's blessings upon each of you. With love and blessings, I In fact, I know what you'd like me to say, and I don't know that I have the courage to say it. God bless you. And in the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Beautiful president. Thank you. Carry the book for you. Yes.
I'm going to ask us to do something which isn't on the program, but let's all sing Happy Birthday. And following that, the choir and congregation will join in singing hymn number 23, We Ever Pray for Thee, Our Prophet Dear, a hymn which was originally written by Evan Stevens in celebration of President Wilford Woodruff's 90th birthday in 1897. The benediction will then be offered by President Howard W. Hunter, President of the Council of the Twelve. And as we in the tabernacle sing Happy Birthday, all of you out there in the many other places where we're meeting, please join in doing so also.
Jerry? Brother Otley?
Holy Eternal Father, as we come to the conclusion of this commemoration, we bow our heads humbly in gratitude for the many blessings which are ours, and in gratitude for the life of one who has been honored here tonight by our faith, our prayers, our uplifted hands, and our voices. Ezra Taft Benson, whom we sustain as prophet, seer, and revelator, and president of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Father, we pray that thou wilt bless him. We pray that thou wilt bless his companion and the members of his family. We pray, Father, that we might be blessed, that we will learn well the lesson that has been taught here tonight. We thank thee for all of the good things that we enjoy, and for the words that have been spoken and sung here to us this evening, in answer to the prayer at the beginning of this meeting, that we have thy Spirit with us. We are grateful for that and all of the other things we enjoy. We pray, Father, for thy benediction upon this lovely evening. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, amen.